everyone, I'm Roma Tunison, and welcome to Curated Conversations, the official podcast series of the Middle East's premier retail and consumer insights hub, Curated Middle East. Curated Conversations is a dynamic platform dedicated to bringing you insightful, high-value industry information that focuses specifically on the evolving landscape in the MENA region. Join us as we speak to some of the region's most prominent movers and shakers as they share their knowledge, experiences, and stories to help you navigate all of the changes we face in the industry today. Hey everyone, welcome to the social media episode of Curated Conversations. Today we're joined by Priya Patel, the product growth lead for Instagram and Facebook in the Middle East, to discuss the evolution of social media as a result of the pandemic and how brands can leverage the platform to elevate their social strategies. Priya, it's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me, Roma.
How have you been?
Very well, thank you.
And I understand that you have been working from home, correct?
That's right. So Facebook was one of the first tech companies globally that closed our offices. We've been working from home since March, so it coincided with the beginning of the general lockdowns globally, and we're still working from home. So we've all adjusted very well. Obviously, we're using our platforms to communicate with each other, and we will be doing that for the foreseeable next few months.
I can imagine you guys, as literally the founders of social media, you must have the infrastructure needed in place to continue working from home for, I don't know, however long this pandemic goes on, isn't it?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. We are very well equipped. We talk to each other a lot through messaging, through video calls, through WhatsApp audio calls, you know, and the rest. And so, you know, we share a lot about each other's lives through Instagram as well. It's very fluid, you know, work, life, relationships, and generally, you know, even though there have been challenges from working at home, everybody has a very positive outlook and we collaborate even more closely together. I think it's also driven the extent and the amount of empathy that we have towards each other even more so.
That's incredible. But what a year, huh?
Yeah.
Like, what a year.
Absolutely.
So I'm curious to know, how has 2020 been for Instagram in the Middle East?
So 2020 has been an interesting year, as you know, for everybody. It's also been a tough year globally as the coronavirus has taken hold and become a public health emergency. What we've done is taken several different steps to ensure that we're becoming a source of credible information. So firstly, we want to make sure that people are accessing accurate information. So they're staying safe, they're staying connected. And so anyone who will search for information related to COVID-19 on Instagram, they see an additional message, a connected message pop up. You may have seen it.
I have, yeah.
So it's a resource that's in conjunction with the World Health Organization and local health ministries as well. And the point of putting that little pop up is to be able to provide credible information so that our users know that if they click on that, they'll be getting the right information from the right source. So what we're also doing is helping to mitigate the spread of misinformation.
I think that's so clever that you've done that, because misinformation is one of the biggest problems in controlling this pandemic. The other day, for example, my dad forwarded me a text message that just didn't make any sense, you know, but he's in his 60s. He's someone who hasn't been exposed to this kind of proliferation of misinformation. You know, it's not something his generation has had to deal with, but someone, his friend forwarded it on to him, so that's a credible source to him, and he forwarded it on to us, and we were like, "Dad, that's not accurate."
Yeah.
Like, don't forward it on. So that's really, really clever. I need to get him onto Instagram.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can relate, and you know, there are things that my parents have sent to me as well, and maybe it is one of these generation things, but it's up to us to then educate them about where the right sources of information are. And as well as that, we've also done quite a lot to help SMBs, particularly in the region, but also globally. Small to medium businesses are a huge part of our community. So during the time when, unfortunately, some of them have had to tamper down their businesses or close their physical businesses, at Instagram, I think we've try to make it easier for them to give things and give services through the platform, but also for our users to discover them, to be able to online order, whether that's food or gift certificates. And then we've also done a series of fundraisers as well, so people can support businesses that they love.
That's incredible. I think any support that businesses of that nature could get during this time is invaluable. So it's amazing to see that you've done that. Has this been globally or just regionally?
This has been something that we've done globally.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. And do you think social commerce is the way forward for brands looking to increase their online presence in this day and age, given the restrictions that COVID-19 has brought upon us?
So what we've seen is a surge in the usage of our platforms, particularly Instagram's, twofold. So as the globe in certain countries went into lockdown, we were seeing that consumers were spending more time on our platform. That inspiration piece has already existed before Instagram. You know, that is one of the platforms for discovery, for imagination, for looking into topics that you're interested in. 90% of us actually follow a business on Instagram. And 87% of people who we've spoken to that use the platform have said that they're already influenced, or they're influenced by somebody having a certain item of clothing or a car or going on a certain break. So the behavior on the platform over this time has just been amplified. What we're seeing is that up to 85% of people are now doing their shopping online. That's general. You know, that doesn't mean it's specific to our platform, but that's just overall because of the consequences of the lockdown. And we've seen that small to medium businesses have really excelled. So I do believe online shopping drives a lot of their business, but also Instagram is making it easier for these businesses to be able to sell their products and services through our platform.
On that topic, I noticed that you launched Instagram tags in the region just a little over a year ago. How has that been going? I imagine with the information that you just shared and with the change in consumer behavior as a result of the pandemic, that the service provided by Instagram must have seen like an exponential increase in the number of users and brands and businesses consuming it. I know that we were talking earlier and you mentioned that there was a change as to how businesses can now apply shopping tags and make the most of it. Could you elaborate a little bit more on what this shift has been?
Yeah, absolutely. So basically at Instagram, we want it to be a place where shopping is fun. It's a fun journey that you go on versus the chore of having to go somewhere and buy things and not necessarily knowing what you want. So we want to make it easier for you to not only buy from your favorite brand, but also to follow new trends or get new opportunities and discover something new. So shopping tags, we launched in the region just over a year ago. It coincided with a global launch, which we started about 2 years ago now. And as with any product launch with Instagram, we tend to test it in some markets and then it slowly rolls out across the rest of the world. So during that time, what we're seeing now globally is that there's been a huge adoption in our users tagging, finding out more about these products. In fact, 130 million people globally have already tapped to reveal product tags in feed, in shopping, in videos, and so on. So the shopping tab essentially makes it easier for you as a small business, whether you're a florist down the road or a bakery or more established, you know, bricks and mortar clothes shop. If you have a catalog and an online presence, it's very easy for you to then go onto Instagram, publish a post of your products on the feed, and then tag up to 5 products in that story that reveal a little price, a little description. You click on that and then it's a very, very easy flow straight to your website to then complete that purchase.
I know I've used it, for sure.
Good, please.
I think shop 90% of everything I need, if not 95% of everything I need online.
Yes.
So for me, having shopping tags has been honestly really bad for my credit card, but really good for my wardrobe. But I wanted to ask about checkout. I know it's not here in the region yet, but that's something that you introduced in some of your other markets. And I think it's the next step from tags, right? Like Instagram checkout, like then you can go ahead and purchase the item via Instagram where all your information is stored in one place. Is that something you envision bringing into the region?
Yes, absolutely. So checkout, we launched in the US last year with around 20 global brands. From the region, we had Huda Beauty as one of those brands, who's very
amazing.
Prolific, obviously, in the beauty and the makeup industry. And so you're right, it's that kind of next step on that makes that shopping journey even more intuitive and obviously a lot easier as well. For now, we're still looking into bringing checkout to the region. Obviously, it's something that's in high demand by all Instagram users globally. We are planning to launch it in a few other markets across Europe imminently, and hopefully we'll bring it to the region in the not too distant future.
I actually wanted to ask you, whilst we're on the topic of high demand services, has it been challenging for you to manage, for example, people moving around, right? Like as Instagram in general, like someone travels to another country, they have access to some different features, then they come to, you know, they come to the Middle East, they experience, they have different features available to them. How do you manage those expectations between different markets? Your main kind of demographic is very well traveled. They're always traveling. They're always off on adventures. They're always gramming where they're at. So how do you manage that?
Yeah, it's a great question. And that's part of my job and my team's job here in the region as well, is to do the education of certain products and services that are coming out on Instagram, and to also manage the expectations of when a specific product is coming. So for example, Instagram Music is available in multiple countries globally. Unfortunately, we don't have Instagram Music in the UAE at the moment. And of course, I get many questions as to around when that will be coming. So, you know, as I said, it's my role to kind of make sure that we're managing these expectations, but that also, you know, they will be coming. So rest assured, everyone who's listening, we will have Instagram Music. We're working on Reels, and all these things hopefully will be coming very soon.
So you brought up Reels. I didn't. So I just want to quickly touch upon short form video content. I mean, it's no secret that it's taken over. It's genuinely a format of content that none of us envisioned becoming as big as it has, right? Like when it started, it was just a few Gen Zers here and there kind of engaging, and it grew, and it was primarily a Generation Z medium or format. And now, as a result of the lockdown, everyone's engaging with it. And in response to that, that's why Instagram has come out with Reels, to cater to that demand. What do you think it is about short form video content that makes it so popular right now?
A number of things. So you picked up on the whole Gen Z demographic.
Yeah.
What we've seen over the last 10 years that Instagram's been available is that shift. The demographic has definitely evolved, and it's kind of the young content creators moment at the moment. So we've seen the enormous power of short form video, as you said. They educate, they entertain, they're very palatable to watch, they're quick, they're short, snappy bits of content that we find are just really resonating, especially with the demographic that are using Instagram. We've also seen that it's evolved when you look at private messaging or stories, the fact that you can send quick 15-second videos to each other. And instead of typing, as what we may do over WhatsApp, yeah, what we're finding is this younger demographic are just sending these short videos to each other.
Oh, so I didn't know that.
There's videos in terms of messaging, there's also videos in terms of Reels. And as you said, because of the huge scope that we saw and just the usage, again, taking it back to the lockdown, the popularity that we were seeing, that this was happening. So Reels launching just felt like such a natural evolution on our platform as well. So we launched globally August 5th. So
how's the response been?
Fantastic so far.
Amazing.
I don't have specific numbers because we are very, it's been 3 months. So we always see how it goes.
That must be an exciting thing to explore and look at.
But it is, it's fantastic. It really is. And it's the sheer creativity that we're seeing is incredible. So every week, you know, at Facebook, I see a page full of different highlights of the week, like different reels, and some of them are just incredible.
I have tried my hand at short form video content, and it's hard. It's time consuming. It is harder than creating a great image just for your feed. It is hard. And then you have to be witty. You have to be original. You have to be creative. And if you're doing one of those kind of, you know, as we've seen people changing outfits, people within 15 seconds, you see 15 different outfits. Like, mm-hmm. Oh my God, that's effort. But it's hard to get it right. It's hard to make it effortless, isn't it?
I wouldn't say it's hard. I think one of the things that we always try and do is make it easier with the tools that we're launching. So I know where you're coming from though. I've tried to do it and it's hard in the sense that you have to stand in the same position that you were before with your new outfit and it takes multiple shots and takes and so on.
But it's a skill set.
It is a skill set. And again, this is where we're saying that, you know, the content creators who have been practicing and living and breathing it for 12 months and more now, they just do it very quickly. And their ideas are in their head. The music's in their head. The moves are there. And so that 15 seconds, for sure, it requires a lot of effort and skill. But for them, I feel like it's kind of second nature.
Yeah, I've seen my younger cousins do it. And they're so good. They pick up the choreography. Oh my God, try to teach me that choreography. It'll take you a day on its own, you know?
Yeah.
So I love it. I think it's addictive. I think it's fun. I think it's exactly the kind of humor and entertainment that people require during lockdown to keep their spirits up. So I'm very excited to see Reels in the region when it does launch. I really wanted to ask about influencers. Because mm-hmm. given the shift in format preference, given the shift in kind of your user profile and demographic, now it's no secret that before lockdown happened, before COVID-19 hit, the demand for influencers, and when I mean influencers, Instagram influencers primarily in the region, was at an all-time high. It was huge. You know, I worked in PR and comms for about 7 years and I've seen it grow in that time. I'm curious to know how these influencers are doing now. What would you say has changed?
It's a great question. And it's one that is topical, as you said. Particularly in the region, huge demand, I think, for what influencers were doing, especially in the fields of lifestyle, fashion, travel, food. And we've seen them flex, adjust to the situations accordingly. A lot of them have actually started using Instagram to shine a light on well-being and health in their own way, with their own authentic stamp and relatable content, which is always a must.
Yeah.
So they've kind of pivoted to create relevant, you know, information that's helped the community stay connected instead. So if we take Karen Wazin, for example, you know, her following has grown significantly over this time. She's close to 5 million now. She's kept her followers entertained by sharing more family moments, having her kids involved, sharing meaningful messages with her followers around, you know, stay at home, but stay positive, stay strong, doing short, impactful videos, saying that, you know, her children are missing their grandparents, things like that. So others can relate. So not so much sort of working with the brands, but more pivoting towards this kind of messaging. Same as if you look at some singers. So there's a Lebanese singer called Mike Massey. He did a series of Instagram lives and sing-alongs and, you know, invited people to watch him when he was releasing different songs and so on. And we saw that globally with Coldplay, John Legend, things like that. But if we go back to influencers, as I said, they've just had to pivot.
And I also think the relevancy, as you said, is so important when it comes to content creation, especially on social media, isn't it? Like, when influencers are speaking to their audiences, they need to be honest and real right now more than any other time before. And I come from a fashion background, and what I've seen is fashion brands as well are looking for those people who were able to connect authentically, mm-hmm. to make the brand relevant to the consumer at a time like this. And we've seen brands in general, even fashion brands, responding by like shifting their product offering to cater to what consumers need right now, whether it's mask, whether it's loungewear. And so, I mean, the theme of relevancy is all over social media and the industry in general.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's capturing the zeitgeist to a certain degree as well, and tapping into where people are from a mental well-being perspective. And like, as you said, you know, brands need to pivot as well.
So we touched upon a little bit on how consumer behavior and engagement has shifted as a result of the pandemic on Instagram. I wanted to ask, have you seen any shift in brand activity on Instagram? Is it higher than ever before? I know there was a time across all industries where things were quiet. I know across the board, we've seen a flurry of activity, and like brands and consumers to an extent have come back stronger than ever. Have you seen this shift on Instagram as well?
Yeah, absolutely, we have. So as we already mentioned, we saw a huge surge in our usage across the world post-lockdown, during lockdown, when consumers were using Instagram to connect with friends and family. In the same way, brands have had to really adjust their marketing strategies to reach out to those consumers at the platforms where they are. So if you're a traditional brand with bricks and mortar stores and up until now hadn't had a very strong digital presence, all of a sudden your marketing and IT teams really need to think about, you know, how are we going to adjust that? What does our marketing strategy look like now for 2020 and beyond to make sure that we're discoverable to people who are now not walking down the high street but are on Instagram? It's the new storefront, it's the shop window. And so how can we now think about what our brand visual looks like through the platform? So we've had that with traditional advertisers. And then we've also seen, you know, digital nascent advertisers or those that already had a healthy footprint pivot towards doing things more imaginative, more creative, doing more stories, IGTV live, you know, getting into reels abroad, Q&As with brand ambassadors, behind the scenes footage, bringing out some of their existing footage and repurposing it to fit the platform so that they could continually drive that usage. If we look at all of the fashion brands, all the fashion houses, in lieu of the shows not happening this summer and this year, they've all now made them live shows on Instagram and, you know, seeding the teasers and the invites and the exclusives out through the platform as well. So that's just one example of how an industry like fashion has changed.
And while we're on that topic, could you give any pointers on how brands in the Middle East could utilize Instagram to elevate their social media strategies? Say, for example, if I've launched a beauty brand within the past few months, give me some pointers, some insider information on how to make Instagram work for me.
Sure. So Instagram is a great place for brands, as we know. And I think I mentioned earlier, 90% of everybody on Instagram follows at least one brand. And so it is that place that you go to for topics that you love. So beauty in particular is a huge industry. And here in the region, we've seen, you know, sole entrepreneurs, SMBs, all use Instagram to highlight kind of what their offering is, generate new leads, drive sales, etc. From a content point of view, and I've touched on it, I feel it just has to be authentic. You have to have a strong brand voice. I think the look and feel needs to stand out. It have the same kind of color, the same tone, the same representation when you're building your brand feed, when you're showing kind of like the different content. So that's from that perspective. And then from a reach perspective, there's organic following. So you build that brand through that eye-catching, authentic content. And then there's the ad spend side of things, which is the business. So once you've established that brand, you've got that organic following, we recommend that businesses start using a little bit of marketing budget to use our, you know, our ad resources to really kind of reach the consumers and your demographic.
Is there a magic formula?
Do you know what? I wish there was, because I definitely have more followers than I work there. But we wouldn't necessarily want to say, post two times a day, post at this time, use these hashtags, etc. We have a rough guidance. Don't post more than two or three times a day on your feed. You know, keep stories to around 10. Use about 6-7 hashtags. Use hashtags that are relevant for your brand, hashtags that might be trending, things like that. But there's no prescriptive if you're a beauty brand, post X, only use these brand ambassadors, only use these influencers. I think a lot of it is, you know, the process of finding out what works for your brand. And that's, again, where Instagram is such a great platform, because you're discovering what works for your brand at the same time as consumers are discovering as well. And they can see past, you know, contrived images or something that just doesn't feel real. I definitely encourage you, if you're a new brand, to, you know, be creative, put tests out there, and don't be cautious around sort of like what that brand offering looks like. So I hope that helps. But the, you know, unfortunately, there's no magic formula.
I was asking for myself.
Yeah, you know.
I had to ask. I have you here. So it was something that I couldn't close the podcast without asking.
I mean, I think we do a lot of education. As I said, you know, it's also a part of my team's job, but we also have an Instagram partnerships team. We have guides that are available to send out to SMBs for how to get established, how to start your journey. We have Facebook Blueprint, which is an entire online curriculum that's available for anyone to take. You or I can take it, a small to medium business.
I had no idea about these resources.
So it's a series of modules. Not only does it teach you about Instagram and how to set up your brand presence there, but also how to utilize Facebook Messenger in similar ways.
You know what? I'm going to get those details from you, and I'm going to put them in the link to this episode and in the description, because I think it's quite important for people to reach out and to use these resources, which I didn't know we even had. For example, my mom runs a clinic, and she's asking me to do her social media for her clinic, you know, and I'm struggling. I really am. Like, I'm not a social media expert, and I think it would be really great to get her assistant training directly from you guys, so that I'm not that middle person anymore. I mean, I have my hands full already. So thank you for that. That's
absolutely
brilliant.
There's a great depth of resource that's available for us. So there's Facebook Blueprint. We have Instagram for Business, which is a great website. We also have the Instagram for Business page on Instagram that shows lots of different case studies of what SMBs are doing globally, how they kind of establish.
And this is accessible to everyone.
Everybody. We'll follow it right now.
I had no idea, guys. If you're looking for your magic formulas, check the links within the description below.
Exactly. You know, there's something that I cannot encapsulate in two sentences.
Of course not. So. No, that's a lot. That's incredible that you have that.
Yeah.
So one last question, as we're limited on time, so we do have to sign off after that. Where do you think social media is headed in the Middle East?
Hey, social media, we're at a really, really exciting stage. Instagram's just had its 10th anniversary a few weeks ago.
Congratulations.
Which is incredible. I've been lucky enough to be a part of the platform and the company for almost half of that now. And in that time, we've just come an incredibly long way. I think more than ever, and some of the things we've spoken about today, it's a stronger platform for discovery, for connectivity, for shopping, for commerce, for brands, all of that. What we've seen particularly, especially during this time, is how people all around the world can kind of rally around each other and support each other. It's becoming one of those platforms where the community is becoming even stronger. So in one way, it's that platform that's evolving for solidarity. From a content perspective, it's really shaping culture in a sense.
Definitely.
So, you know, there's a shift of power from the organization to the individual. So some of the examples I can reference is like, look at athletes. Athletes are now arguably more relevant than teams. If we look at the following that Cristiano Ronaldo has, for example, he's one of the most followed people on Instagram ever. And that's just one example. And also artists, you know, artists can showcase their work through Instagram as opposed to being in galleries and museums. Musicians can reach their audiences without going through the official sort of like, you know, the album release, the store visits, et cetera, et cetera. Their authentic voice is now available.
A lot of people have been discovered as a result of Instagram.
Absolutely.
As well, right? Like, record labels actually go on social media to find this kind of talent.
Yeah. So, I mean, that goes back to that power of short video that we were talking about earlier. That place for the discovery, whether that's photography, whether that's art, whether that's you're a musician, that talent has definitely been discovered on our platforms.
I've always said that social media is especially Instagram itself, has democratized society in so many ways. Like, it's gone exactly how you said, or the power has moved away from the organization to the individuals themselves. And you don't have to be from the right family or from the right, I don't know, university to get discovered. If you have the talent, you can actually make it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And culture is a collection of stories that we tell. And as Instagram, we believe that everybody's got something to tell, their own unique point of view. It does democratize everything because you're right. It doesn't have that kind of class system. It doesn't matter where you live. You know, as long as you're on the platform, you have that camera on your phone. You know,
and you have a voice.
Yeah, absolutely. We also have to adapt. We're keeping up with the pace ourselves. And over the coming months, you'll see more changes, like Reels, like shopping, improvements to messaging. And we're always looking for ways to accelerate how, you know, creators can make a living and small businesses can also sell their products. So the community and businesses are both a heart of us, a heart of Instagram. And we're really excited for what's coming up in the future as well.
Well, you guys are going to be busy because things are changing so quickly,
so
isn't
busy.
It? Well, that's it for today. So thank you so much for coming on, Priya. I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been great talking to you.
And what did you think of your first podcast?
It was great. Good. Thank you so much for making it so relaxed.
Oh, well, it's my absolute pleasure. And congratulations again on your 10-year anniversary. I can't wait to see what you guys do within the next 10. It actually blows my mind a little bit that Instagram is only 10 years
young. Right? Think about that footprint. We're just so excited. There's so much coming up. So hopefully I'll be back soon to talk to you about the next launches.
Very excited to hear about them. Thanks so much. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
We hope you enjoyed today's episode. And if you did, please make sure you hit subscribe and leave us a comment below, as we would love to hear from you. Also, be sure to head over to www.curatednow.me and sign up for the official Curated Middle East newsletter. Thanks for listening.